Let's take a look now at the idea of confidence intervals for univariate data. By univariate data, what that refers to is simply one variable. Now, as usual, let's take a look at the learning objectives, what we want to get out of these next series of videos. First of all, we want to be able to construct and interpret an interval estimate for a population parameter. We want to be able to understand the difference between a point and interval estimate. We want to identify appropriate parameters to estimate based on the data. And I want to understand the relationship between the margin of error and sample size. Those are some of the key ideas here. Now, to start off with, just something for you to keep in mind as we start progressing through this and developing all the tools that you need to actually put together a confidence interval. The general form of a confidence interval will always be the point estimate. Plus and minus the margin of error. That will give us, on a number line, a point estimate. I'm just going to say PE for point estimate right now. If I add the margin of error, I'll be up here on the number line. If I subtract the margin of error, I'll be down here. This forms an interval on the number line. And that's what we're talking about here. We start talking about confidence intervals. So keep this in mind. It's always going to have the form, the point estimate plus or minus the margin of error. So what we need to do is define just what a point estimate is and then figure out what the margin of error is. Now, a point estimate is the single value of a sample statistic used to estimate a population parameter. You already know a bunch of point estimates. As an example, X bar, that's the sample mean. It's used to estimate mu. X bar is a point estimate. S, that's the sample standard deviation. That's used to estimate sigma. S is a point estimate. M, the sample median. That's a point estimate. It's a single value. It's used to estimate theta, the population median. P hat, sample proportion. That's used to estimate pi, the true proportion. We will actually work out confidence intervals for X bar, the median, and P hat. Actually, I said that wrong. We will work out confidence intervals for mu, theta, and pi, all based on X bar, M, and P hat. Although point estimates are in fact extremely useful, they really provide no feeling of how good, and by good, I guess you can see how accurate, there's a couple other words you could easily put in there, but how good the estimate is. An interval estimate is bounded by two values, and what's important here to understand is that those values are actually calculated from the sample data. Since they're calculated from the sample data, they're sample statistics. The very loose and general definition of a sample statistic is anything that's calculated from sample data. And we use those to estimate a population parameter. So rather than using a single value, we use a point estimate as the center of the interval. And create upper and lower bounds where we're confident the true parameter value will reside. So in other words, if I go back up to this drawing, suppose this point estimate, let me erase that. Let's just say that was actually P hat. There's a point estimate, sample proportion. And then if I add, subtract the margin of error, I have this interval. And what I'm saying is that I believe that pi, the true proportion, is somewhere on that interval. I don't know where, but I believe it is somewhere on this interval. Now, when we actually compute an interval estimate, we do so in such a way that we have a specific level of confidence that the parameter value will actually be in the interval. The level of confidence is actually the probability that the confidence interval, I'm going to just abbreviate that CI, will contain the parameter. So in other words, if I build, say, a 95% confidence interval for pi, so I have this interval, and maybe it looks like, I'm going to make something up here, 0.41 to 0.51. What I'm saying is, I don't know the value of pi, but I'm 95% certain that whatever pi is, it's somewhere on that interval. Now, the actual interval that we're going to build is referred to as, I've been using the term CI, as a confidence, interval. Now, just as a brief review, you know that we discussed the assumptions much earlier when we discussed the idea of the binomial distribution, the normal distributions. There are certain assumptions that we had to have satisfied before we could use those distributions. As a reminder, a statistical assumption, that means that it's an assumption that we use in statistics for data analysis, is a condition that must exist, or at least reasonably so, in order to properly use a statistical procedure. It's required for the procedure to be valid. It's extremely important. Assumptions are incredibly important. If we do not properly address the assumptions for a specific technique that we want to use, then really we have absolutely no business using that technique. Now, this is an extremely important concept right here. A confidence interval is always, always, always used to estimate a population parameter. You're trying to figure out the parameter value. It's never used to estimate a sample statistic. Sample statistics are used to construct the confidence interval so that we can estimate the population parameter. Remember, typically the name of a game here is trying to figure out what a true average is from a population. And we can't do a census, so we have to do the best we can to estimate it based on a sample. Now, everything we calculate from that sample could be considered a sample statistic. And the whole point is we're going to use these statistics, the point estimates, and the margin of error. The margin of error will be actually be constructed from of sample statistics to be certain at some level. Remember earlier I said I have a specified level, as an example, 95% certain, 98% certain, 90% certain, whatever, that the population parameter falls in there. Now think about it just for a second. If I told you that some candidate, based on an analysis, looked like was going to get, 53% of the vote. It sounds like that candidate is really kicking some tail, really doing a nice job. You know, right now you'd say that if the election happened today, they'd win. That sounds pretty impressive. But what if I said, I think they're going to get 53% of the vote, plus or minus 20%. Well, now all of a sudden we have an interval that can go as low as 33%, as high as 73%. And what we're now saying is that we believe pi, the true proportion that's going to vote for this person, falls somewhere in here. We just went from, man, they are, looks like they're really going to win. They're doing very, very well. Down to, wow, they could really win or they could really get trounced, one of the two. We don't know. See, that's what I meant earlier when I said by simply providing a point estimate, a single value, it does nothing in terms of telling you how good the estimate is. A confidence interval will give you a much better idea of how good the estimate is. And quite frankly, if I did some type of research and I said the proportion is 53% plus or minus 20%, I'm thinking that's pretty useless. And what that really means, and we'll get to this a little bit later, is that the sample size was not big enough. But anyway, I think that's a pretty good introduction to what confidence intervals are all about. So now we need to take a look at exactly how we will construct them for the mean, the median, and the proportion.